So then, with the knowledge of the material time derivative, it's actually quite easy to write down the conservation of mass statement. So what we'll do here is we're going to write down something different, a different concept, but it's quite easy. And that is, we're going to assume that we have a control mass, right? So normally we're dealing with concepts like control volumes, right? But here we're going to talk about a control mass, right? And we're going to just follow this mass as it undergoes some motion, right? So we'll define a reference configuration. And in the reference configuration, and I, you know, I'm drawing in a 2D plane here, but this could be a three-dimensional blob. So in the reference configuration, the mass, the domain of the mass, is sort of the collection of points which we'll label omega. And in the reference configuration, I'll always try to use a subscript 0, right, just to be clear. So in the reference configuration, this is the sort of time t equals to 0 configuration. Right? Then we have the collection of particles, and again, we'll give our coordinate system here. Omega 0 is the collection of particles associated with all of the points x in this blob, in this reference blob. Okay? And our blob is going to undergo some motion over time, right? And during that motion, right, this is a fixed volume of, it's a fixed mass that we're going to follow, right? It's a fixed number of particles x. That we're going to follow over time, and our blob may take on some new shape at some new time, but associated with the position of every vector x in the reference configuration, there's some mapping, okay, some mapping that's a function of x that takes us to its deformed image. And so again, we'll use the symbol little x here. So this is the same point that was in the reference configuration. Now it's been deformed, and we'll call this the current configuration. So now that that's been deformed, and now, you know, I've purposely drawn this with sort of a different shape because the shape can change, the volume can change, but yet this is the same fixed mass, okay? And the new domain, the new collection of particles, again, which has the same mass, is going to be labeled without the subscript. So we'll use omega without the subscript here, okay? Now, it should be clear that, you know, because this mapping chi takes us from big X to little x, then, you know, little x is itself a function, right? Little x is defined as the function chi. That's a function of big X and time, right? We've already established, using the concepts from earlier, using the same labels, that little x is a function of time. Okay, so we're going to make quite possibly the most simple statement of conservation of mass ever, right? Because what we have here is we said from the beginning that this is a control mass. So this is the same mass that we're following from one position to another as it undergoes some motion, right? And so we're literally just going to say that the mass of the domain in the reference configuration is equal to the mass of the domain in the current configuration. Or in differential form, we might write so, you know, recall that the domain omega is just the collection of all points x, right? And so if we have, you know, all points big X, right? So in differential form, then any differential mass element is associated with X in that case, okay? Now, we're interested in, I haven't really mentioned it or been clear yet, but this mass we're following, this is the mass of a fluid in a porous medium, right? I mean, that's what we're interested in studying in this class. So this is a fluid, this is the mass of fluid as it undergoes some motion inside a porous medium, right? And so the mass of fluid in a porous media, right, is, well, I guess let's first define the volume, right? So the volume in the reference configuration, again, the volume of the fluid, is the porosity, okay? I'm sorry, let's to be clear. The volume of the differential mass, okay, the volume of the differential mass in the reference configuration is the porosity times the volume. Okay. And so then therefore the differential mass would just be the density times the volume. Likewise, in the current configuration, we have the density, right, which is now a function of little x, and time times the porosity, which again is a function of little x, and time times the differential volume. So then if we want to go back to the total mass, we would just integrate this over the domains. Like so. Now this is a volume integral, so we could rewrite it, be more explicit here. This is the volume integral, which is the triple integral over the domain likewise over the domain in the current configuration. We have this. Now, you might remember from Calc 3, from Calculus 3, vector calculus, I guess, from multivariate calculus, that when you have a volume integral like this, you can do a change of coordinates, you know, particularly if the coordinates, so in this case, remember, the coordinate little x is a function of this mapping chi and a function, which is a function of big X and t, right? And so we can actually use this to do a change of coordinates to take little x into big X. And the way you do that is through this so-called Jacobian determinant. So you might remember that. Back to the volume here. And now we're going to use the coordinate transformation to take from the current configuration back to the reference configuration through the Jacobian determinant. So we're going to call that J. I'll write out explicitly what J is in a second. But now we have performed a coordinate transformation so that the little x's that appeared here before are now big x's. And J is the determinant, okay, of, and you know, a lot of times you would, well, we'll say that it's the determinant of, I'm going to use the symbol F, and F is a matrix, right? And what it is then explicitly is so it should be clear, you know, any component of the matrix F, say the IJ component, then is just FXI partial XJ. And, you know, again, if it's not clear, these are the components. Okay, so now we have this, returning to this equation, and just now that we have everything over the, you know, the volume, the integrals over the same volumes, I'll just return one last time and write it in terms of a volume integral, a little bit simplified notation. This and what we know here now, or what we can say now, is that this equation must hold for any volume dV, right? I mean, our differential volume was arbitrary at the beginning, and so if it's truly arbitrary, then it doesn't matter the size of the volume, differential volume dV, then the integrand, you know, must be also equivalent, right? And so we can actually just write this, forgot my J here. Like this. And this is a statement of conservation of mass. Sometimes you see this as a material form of conservation of mass. Now, this is not in the form that we're typically used to seeing it, right? In your other classes, you certainly didn't do it this way, where you made arguments from a balance law perspective. But what we'll show now is that this is, in fact, entirely equivalent to the previous derivations that you may have seen for conservation of mass. And what we did here was really nothing too exciting at all. We just said that we have a control mass that we're going to follow as it undergoes some motion. And then we just say that the mass at time t equals to zero must equal the mass after some time t and some motion. And then we just use arguments from calculus 3 or vector calculus to write down this statement of conservation of mass. Okay, so we haven't really done anything too exciting.